KFCF 88.1 FM in Fresno, your listener-supported free speech radio for Central California. I'm Janet Flores. This show is Art Attack. And today in the studio, we have Deron Lyons. Hi, Deron.
How are you?
I'm good. It's so good for you to come in. I'm so happy you're here today to tell us you have a whole bunch of stuff going on at Gallery 25. Not this coming weekend, but the following weekend.
The following, yes.
Of the 29th, 30th, and 31st. And so let's sort of take it in order of the three events that you have coming up.
Okay.
The first one is on Friday, January 29th, starting at 6 p.m., you'll be screening the multidisciplinary feature-length film that you co-directed called Goodbye, Victoria. So tell us about Goodbye, Victoria.
Goodbye, Victoria, yes, is a feature-length narrative film that I co-directed with Matthew Potter, a good friend of mine. And it stars William Patrick Schaefer. And like you said, the film will start at 6. We'll open the doors at 5:30 at Gallery 25 and try to get situated. But the film is a dramatization of the American dream in a certain sense, and also the California dream. So Bradley is from Charleston, South Carolina, and he can't find work. And so he's a little dismayed about that. And so he pursues this pipe dream of breaking into the entertainment industry and or attempting to do so and try to become an actor in California. So the subtext of the film is that, you know, times are tight, times are really rough in this lackluster economy. It's a meditation on the American dream having dwindled from somebody pulling themselves up from their bootstraps and working hard to hopefully becoming the next star in American Idol. That's kind of the sentiment of the film. So we chronicle his attempt at doing this and pursuing, you know, directors and producers, and he's always trying to be on the hunt for that opportunity, and it never really comes. It's very elusive to him.
It is in real life.
Right, exactly. And you really kind of see this character go through this metamorphosis where he is somebody who's overconfident to the point of being annoyingly arrogant. So you start off the film really not really liking this character.
Yeah.
And I like to say, in much the same way that you don't really like Goldie Hawn's character in the 1987 film Overboard.
Okay.
You have a disgust for him, but slowly but surely he goes through all this turmoil, and hopefully that experience of watching him go through these bad things will inculcate some compassion in the viewer.
Interesting. Yeah. When you were first telling me about this movie, I thought it was more of a documentary, like this was true. So, but this is all a story that
it plays with aspects of documentary filmmaking, because we really were trying to be really faithful to how these youngsters are, scenesters really in the South are living their lives. So it kind of blurs the line between kind of picturing things as they are,
yeah,
and then fictionalizing that and creating a story out of it. So it kind of goes back and forth, I think.
So does the character of Brad have any transformation through the course of the film?
He does. He actually starts to, I think, feel a little remorse for how he mistreats his girlfriend. He's kind of rude and obnoxious towards her. That's part of the whole thing. When she was pressuring him, you know, you need to get a job here. You need to be asserting yourself. Be a little more responsible. How are we going to have a future? This type of discussion is going on. And so he said, I can't find anything in Charleston. So I'm going to go out to California, and I'm going to do something, and maybe you can come out there with me. Well, he really starts to miss her quite a bit, and he says in his process of learning through these hardships that he probably should straighten his life out a little bit.
So he transforms in a certain way, but also the viewer. You're more interested in how the viewer transforms in their thinking about this person, or
right,
their compassion towards this person or whatever.
Hopefully you will see some people go from really the spectrum of disliking him completely to saying, oh, that's kind of too bad that these things are taking place. Yeah.
Okay, so that's called Goodbye, Victoria, and that's the movie that you co-directed with Matthew Potter.
Right.
The next day, Saturday the 30th, starting at noon, you're bringing the PICO National Network Archives. The archives themselves have about 1,500 images, but you're not bringing all 1,500 images. But tell us about what the PICO National Network Archive is.
It's an archive of photographs that depict people who either have no health insurance or have coverage that's not sufficient for what their condition might be, or someone is depicted in the picture who's talking about a family member who might not have been available to be photographed, but their condition, or a friend, their condition, and how they don't have the appropriate coverage to take care of themselves, really.
I told the doctor, no. But my kids were there, and they said, you need to, you know, not think about the bill. And I was very afraid, because you go with a stomachache, an emergency, and then the next morning they tell you they have to cut you open. It was just shocking and very, very scary. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to pay this bill before I die, you know? It's a $50,000 bill that I got. But one way or the other, I'm gonna have to.
And so how did you find the PICO National Network?
This is Seth and Hannah Gravett's brainchild, in the sense that they had an experience in a San Diego town hall meeting where they saw this groundswell of aggression and anger, people shoving one another, carrying Hitler signs, and it was really, really over the top.
Surrounding the healthcare debate.
Surrounding the healthcare reform debate. And so they looked at this and they said, wow, we have to do something to try to make the tone of the debate more civil. We have to try to do something. And they don't really want to take a posture on it that we're trying to pressure the insurance companies or pressure the legislation to look in a certain way. They with this project anyway, they more want to just show people, look, these are the folks in their own words and what they're going through.
Mm-hmm.
And try to, again, inculcate some type of compassion in the viewer.
These are individual people.
Right.
These are how we deal with not having health care.
Yes.
How other, you know, how people are being impacted because the cost of health care is so high and because they don't have coverage for it.
Right.
Which is also so high. So it's obviously it's a problem.
Majorly problematic, right. This exhibition, I think, has traveled now to 18 venues in the continental U.S. It's been to New York a number of times, Washington, D.C. I know Barbara Boxer and Dianne Feinstein have both seen the archive of images. Uh-huh. So it comes with a lot of really great political cachet to our gallery. So it's really a treat to get to see it. And it's going to saturate the entire, we have about an 80-foot long south wall that's 20 feet tall.
Uh-huh.
Really daunting space, but it's going to fill that pretty well. So.
Oh, good. So you're also inviting people to become part of this archive.
Right.
Tell us about that.
If anyone wants to kind of step forward and say, look, I have a similar story and I would like to spotlight it, then we have a installation where people can come and have their portrait shot and then they can write their story down on a piece of paper. And then that text goes over the top of the portrait.
Oh.
Not over the face, but it's incorporated into the space.
Into the portrait.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So if anybody listening would like to be a part of that archive. And I'm sure that will keep growing, because if it's gone California to New York, it's not going to stop traveling around.
It's on kind of a perpetual tour, I think, is how they describe it. They want to get it shown as many times as possible.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, I really especially appreciate the idea that they're trying to foster more civil discourse.
Right.
Okay, so that's happening. Were you going to say something else?
What I was going to say was, when you approach this archive of images, I think that there's some sort of a sublime response that you might have, because you might have healthcare now, but what happens if an unfortunate series of events take place and you develop a condition or you lose your job and now you don't have coverage. I mean, the chances is that a great number of the people who actually look at the archive might wind up being qualified to be a part of it. It's really a beautifully done series of photos. So it's beautiful and scary all at the same time.
Yeah.
And so I think it's a pretty compelling piece, and that's why I'm really happy that we get to show it.
We're talking to Duron Lyons and about a really interesting threesome of events that you have going on at Gallery 25 next weekend. The third thing also sounds equally interesting and coming from a different point of view. I mean, these are three things that are really, I wouldn't think to have these all three together on one weekend. But the third thing is political remix videos. And that's happening right after the PICO National Network archive show. So at 4:30, then you're going to start a show with political remix videos for about 2.5 hours. You've got 40 shorts.
Yeah, about 40. I'm thinking of including a couple more that are being produced kind of towards the last minute here. But if I could back up a little bit quick, the way that I think these three events thread together is because they all three have political undertones, of course, but they all use illusion to project bigger issues behind the illusion.